5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
You are now listening to the Andronicus Transmissions with Jessica Ariel Morocco. www.readingspotariel.com. Visit YouTube for more videos at Jessica Ariel Morocco. Voices by Ian.
Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us today at the Andronicus Transmissions. And yeah, there's been quite a gap before we last had the show, but so much has been happening, and I really didn't get the green light to share some of the things that I was interacting with and dealing with. Obviously, a lot of things have been happening on the planet, and some things that are quite disturbing. I've had people contacting me at all different times of the day and night, and telling me about, you know, different anomalies, things that happened in California. You know, of course, this submarine incident that happened that I had an awareness of before the news really picked it up and started talking much about it. There's just, you know, lots and lots of things. And, of course, you know, there's other things regarding my lab's Monarch. Some of the Nazi stuff we're gonna dig right in today. I finally have the green light to share some of the information. Obviously, if you start sharing the information prematurely, then you know, something can happen, you know, in a negative way. And so you really don't want anyone to be in harm's way, or you don't want any type of weird retaliation. We are dealing with interdimensional cross sections of time. And, you know, it may look like something's happening here in real time, but the influence is coming from maybe, you know, who knows, 200 BC or something, or some other weird, you know, time slip or alternate reality or parallel. Or you never know. I usually trace it to the origin of some of the locations. So, but to the most people, they look at it and, you know, It's either, one nation or another in their minds. You know, it's either, you know, it's the Russians, or it's the Chinese, or it's the Americans, or it's, you know, somewhere in the EU, or, you know, you never know, you know. But behind those things are multiple influences. And so when I'm talking about these things, and some people say, well, you know, that's just weird, that's bizarre, you know, that doesn't make any sense. And if you don't have an awareness of, you know, the influences surrounding us, that there is an impression of somewhere else, something going on elsewhere, then, you know, some of this is too far out for you. But for those that understand and are already, you know, connecting to the dimensional space, who have their third eye open, have an awareness, are already seeing some of these things. So this is nothing new, other than they might not have more of the details. This is where I come in and can provide some of the information. Now, I'm getting my information from multiple galactic sources, and I'm able to observe and see what's going on and how things are kind of sneaking through the cracks and influencing, or have been here all along, and we've just grown accustomed to it and think it's normal. But when that energy is removed, two things happen. The energy is removed, which creates a bit of a gap, or, you know, it gets a little quiet, and so those that were working with that system feel that influence drops off. And then the second thing that happens is another group tries to jump in and fill that space, and if they can, rehook into the entire audience, so you have this huge demographic that you're now able to broadcast to. So it's almost like it has like a little bit of a power gap there, and or a power seat. And so some of these, you see them like all these like switching of hands and, you know, strange things happening where one moment we're having a problem here, then we're having a problem over there. It's jumping around. This is related to the beings that we're interacting with. But not to go too deep into that, you're going to see some of the things that have happened. We have a message from Rhodan, Andronicus, Meetis, and someone new from Andromeda came in to help us in another area by the name of Hans. All right, so without further delay, we're going to bring in Ian and say hello, Ian.
Hi, Jess. Long time.
yeah, it's been, how long has it been, Ian?
I would guess 3 or 4 weeks, which is probably the longest rest period we've had, isn't it?
Yeah, and I wish I could call it a rest period, but
yeah, it's been exactly. There's so much going on, yeah.
Off the hook. It's been nonstop, overwhelming at times. Working through and trying to breaking down some of these really, really parasitical systems, the really bad ones that people are trying to get free of, and you know, you keep on finding groups of people that want to break free from, whether it's Monarch, My Labs, you know, trying to find how they're connected, disconnect them, help them to liberate themselves, help them to recollect, retain some of their soul essence that was extracted, try to break any type of control system that's manipulating the current life. So all these like crazy things are happening, whether it's personal sessions or working with groups or working with the planet, also the attacks that have been going on, that trying to create conflict. And I want to say, you know, since the past 5 years or so, and it's probably been going on before then, I mean, it has been going on before then, this really strong effort by the alternate species that would love to bring in from multiple agendas, not just one agenda, but multiple agendas to bring in a World War III. And so, and unfortunately, some people that are doing disclosures or whatever, thinking that they're providing some of the information that's necessary, or even, you know, unintentionally supporting what some of their agendas are and why that humans need to go through these experiences. And so that's the kind of stuff where I try to, you know, remind everyone, you know, let's keep our eyes open and you'll see some of that information. But I'm sorry, Ian, I'm just chatting away here.
No, please do. No, I'm kind of looking, after reading through the transmissions, there's a lots of interesting bits and pieces there. So I'm kind of looking forward to getting in and dissecting it.
Yeah. We can pretty much jump in there. And, you know, thanks for your patience. And kind of you've been there the whole time in the background and patiently waiting for me to come through with some information. So finally we have something. And if there's anything else, you know, along the way, I'm sure you'll have some feedback and some things that you want to share regarding it.
Yeah, sure, Jess.
Okay, so let's see which one we're going to go with first. Okay, so we're going to start with Meetis. I mean, this is the way it came in. And usually Meetis is at the end, but
hello, Flower. We have learnt so much lately about your world and your future. Times are changing. Nothing that was will ever be again. The Time Master Kronos has reset his clock from darkness to light. I think you know what I mean. The sifting of the hours and time lifts the piece of sand one grain at a time. You found it, didn't you? The Sandman.
That wasn't the original Sandman, was it?
In fact, there were two. I thought I'd mention it, but then I was told you would look for them and it doesn't work that way. You would miss so many things in the process. Besides, they needed to see you could find it. They want you to prove who you are in order for you to go further. I know you understand this.
I do. So the other one looks like a wizard and has many names. He too has lost his influence.
Yeah. He created many time-slip anomalies around me.
I saw what caused the Mandela effect last night. It was on Alcyon Gate that was overrun by Dracos. The Alcyon, 12 deep Pleiadians were accessing the gate to enter the planet and then allowing many to time travel who shouldn't have permission. And then they had free access to our timelines. Then they got overtaken by the Dracos, and they were creating hybrid species of Dracos and Pleiadians. So then someone showed me a picture of an ancient Roman statue and there it was. I asked if they were Caesars, and they said no, that this is what the plebeians looked like. They said in some way, the hybrid group made good workers, so they had them farming and doing other tasks while the Roman Empire thrived.
They have mixed with your human race and had many other breakout societies where they were in early human frontiers as well as breakaway Christian groups who wanted to worship in their own way apart from the mainstream belief system. It was their aspect of Palladian that made them want to have their own rulership, and combined with the brutish ways of the Draco, they wanted to build, construct, and live under harsh situations, of which they were kind of very able to do. You may notice that they survived some of the harshest living conditions, and many thrived traveling across the United States when others disappeared through harsh weather conditions, conflicts with native people, and landscapes that had many challenges. The Alcyon Gate is now closed and never to be open again, while they became set before a higher power to be responsible for what damage they had caused on the planet. They are one of many groups who have manipulated time to create agendas.
Right. And can I ask if that wizard I saw was from the land of the wizards, and if they were also deliberately working to create anomalies on the planet for a specific or not-so-good agenda?
Let's just say they were friends with Poseidon. Need I say more?
Yeah, I suppose that sums it up in a nutshell. Well, I know that Poseidon, or Triton, as we remember him, took over the Neptune Society. What I recently discovered is that he did horrible things to the original Neptunian beings, and they were the true kings of Atlantis. The true kings of Atlantis are beginning to wake up to who they were, and they also, or who they are, and they also recall many crimes that were done to them by Triton. It is beyond words to talk about, almost. So very sad. So one of the kings, here now as a human, or incarnated, remembered me when I had red hair on Neptune, only they didn't realize it was on Neptune. He also removed memory from them. They saw that I was a child or a daughter to the first king and described me perfectly. How could the king remember so clearly without me even telling him? I know it happened, and we have many records of galactic history that is now unfolding. The truth will ever be revealed.
So continue to look for the truths while we set the many timelines back to their original path. No more soul harvesting on wrong timelines that lead nowhere, or even worse, to a slave camp. This time we regain control. It has been worth it all, Flower. Not much more to say other than we are not fully finished, but on the brighter side of things.
That's very good news, Meetis. Thank you for confirming what I have been seeing, and of course, Much gratitude for your help and difficulties you have endured to help us all find our way through things.
Fare thee well to all my friends of lovely old England and those who remember me. I shall speak to your hearts again in a rhyme. Lovely, just lovely. I much love my kindred folk across the ocean. You are loved beyond measure.
Okay, so let's take a look at what Meetis had to say. He brings up immediately, he starts talking about time. He brings up Chronos, he brings up the hourglass and the idea of how sand, the pieces of sand, one grain at a time, sifting the hours of time. And then he brings up that I found the Sandman. Interesting enough, the book that I talk about, Macabre, Short Stories and Poems from the Other Side, one of the stories in there is about the Sandman. And the first time that Peter the Insider brought up to me the one from Mobius called Kara Sandman. And Mobius and some of the other programs that I thought, well, this is quite interesting, you know, because I had already talked about a Sandman, but now Meetis is revealing to me that there were two of them. But I'm sure that there are many that wanted to get involved with the altering of time, and this is the whole concept of time travel, which seems to go in and out of our conversations. So he starts talking about it, and he says, one looks like a wizard and has many names. That's what I said to him. And he said that this wizard one created many time slips and anomalies around him in particular. So he says around me, and he's talking about himself. So very much probably the wizard one was targeting Meetis and trying to cause him problems. Which makes me think that if it was his time period, it might have been more of a Merlin type. And then I said, I saw what caused the Mandela effect, which is also regarding time slips and some other issues. And it was because this Alcyon, this gate from Alcyon, which is in the Pleiades, was, you know, connecting into the Earth. And they were the negative ones were going through the Alcyon gate. Not, you know, not all Alcyon Pleiades were bad. I think that something shifted dimensionally or something happened and they were stepping through the gate. And then there was an overthrow of their civilization by the Dracos. And I saw it very clearly. In my opinion, and I know that people might, the reason why I found this is because I was tuning into what was going on in California regarding some of these earthquakes. And in desperation of, you know, quite a few of my friends who were feeling it directly, wanting it to stop. And I know that people say, well, this is military, or this was, you know, done by, you know, some kind of directed energy weapons. And so I'm going step back. I'm going dimensionally back, and the ability and the direction guided anyone to, you know, be handled and puppeted to do this stuff started from this portal that had their agendas. And the reason why they were lashing out in particular is because they knew that they got caught. Because prior to that, a week before all of this happened, I identified and located a bunch of these Dracos that were in that. It was about possibly four worlds of theirs that were moving through the space, and I asked to have it removed. I had the Draco civilization removed, and I realized that there were some hybrids that were there because they had kind of imposed themselves upon the Alcyon Pleiadians, and they, of course, were agreeable, whether coerced or not, it did happen. And so then I later find out that this is where the plebeians came from. This was a group that was found during the early Roman times. Now, often I've talked about the Maximus Rufus and how they came in from the first revolution of humanity. And I believe that there may even be some before them, but our pre-Adamic group. And during that time that they had their leadership and control and manipulation, and so then they brought in this hybrid group because they're good workers. And of course, you know, any type of species that comes in here likes their slave system because they don't want to do anything. They don't like manual labor. They don't like to have to build or create. Not all of them have the type of tech. They do have anti-gravity and all that, but, you know, they're trying to appear that they're blending in with humans and not to look directly, distinctly ET so that it doesn't really stand out. So there's always this facade and kind of making themselves kind of blend in and look like they're human. But yet they need all of these things because they're high maintenance, I guess. And so they bring in this group. So we have this discussion. So we go from the ones that are altering time and messing with the timekeeper, Kronos, and then altering time-space for us, and then having this ongoing gate coming from Alcyon that was disrupted, which created a retaliation. And so in some way, maybe the removal of some of the Dracos created a retaliation, but maybe not. And maybe their plan was already to do that in a much higher level. But I will say that there's more to this, and maybe at some point I'll feel more comfortable to share about some other area that I did visit in California to try to minimize what they wanted to do to this San Andreas Fault, because I know that they wanted to do something. So I was sent out there, and part of it was to neutralize the effect of whatever they were trying to do. So here it was, you know, it was already planned, or they kind of anticipated something was going to happen. So they struck and did something to create a disturbance. I think they intended to do something bigger. But yeah, that's how these things kind of tie in and work for whatever this cause is. So we, you know, talk about the Mandela effect, you talk about the plebeians and the Alcyon group. And in the end, what does he say? Well, they're just friends of Catriton, Poseidon. So it's really kind of weird. It's very, very weird how this Neptune society and Atlantis is trying to come up. So you got multiple things happening dimensionally that are trying to resolve. And remember, the timelines are a mess, or they're kind of not in their proper place yet. And so we still have one thing triggering another thing that's seemingly unrelated, but it's creating this kind of weird linear effect that probably wouldn't happen but because of this strange intersection of timelines, you're having one thing trigger another, and you're finding and what I'm discovering is some unusual alignment with different groups that I didn't see as being connected before. So it seems like we call them negatives, but you know, one has one agenda, another one has another agenda, and it's coming out at the same time. And that was the confusing part. It was hard for me to come out and explain what I was seeing because I was still trying to wrap my head around it and saying, how in the world are these things coming out? And there's at the same time, there was no rhyme or reason to it other than the fact that the timelines were messed up. So here we go. And then in the end, Meetis mentions that he is going to be connecting to people. I guess you'll hear some kind of rhyme or something that he's if he wants to reach out to you. But yeah, very loving, very warm message, but at the same time, very informative. Ian, let me know your thoughts.
Yeah, so two Sandmen, or one Sandman and one Sandwoman. So I will be saying that one of the Sandmen, the one that was confusing Meetis, was Merlin.
Yeah, it was like a Merlin type. I was figuring that he says he goes by many names. So who knows, it might have been Merlin.
Yeah, because I've never quite sussed that out, if the name Merlin is a position, you know, is like a level of wizardry.
Yeah.
But he seems to command a very important position in our culture and the things he does, doesn't he? You know, he introduces new lines of kings and plays around with time, and, you know, so he's not just kind of someone who sat there with a book, and, you know, he seems a very influential character. Yeah,
very, very influential. And but so we're looking at, you know, someone that Merlin might have been one expression of the many expressions of this wizard, and it's really hard to tell because, you know, the land of the wizards was quite old. When you know, we did channel that space, it's a very mystical space. I think some of them were, you know, connected to the druids. It's, someone asked me, they said, are the druids and the wizards, are they all bad? And I said, it all depends on what they did with their abilities. So the actual, the earth magic, you know, some could say, well, you know, if you're in an area and you don't get enough rain and you have crops and you connect to the earth and you have it rain so that people can eat or whatever. I think being connected to the earth and understanding the magic of the earth, and there were certain practices, same thing with working with herbs and things like that, is our earliest medicine. So then, you know, somehow it got associated with witchcraft, which witchcraft is an intention and certain practices to harm others. But the earth magic is to harnessing, because everything is alive and has this amazing energy to it naturally, in understanding that. So the druids worked with the trees, they worked with protecting their territory, they did all sorts of things. So it depends on what the intention was, and if your intention was to harm others in the process, then I guess anyone could be, you know, whether it was good or bad, you know?
Yeah. And going down to the plebeians, it's interesting. I've not really been aware of any difference in ancient Rome, but there was the patricians, who were the elder group, the politicians.
Mm-hmm.
And then the plebeians were kind of like the working class, but they weren't from Rome. And I'm reading on one of these kind of wiki-like pages, and it says that the origins of the plebeians was undocumented. But then they said, this is not surprising because they don't normally do that, blah, blah, blah. But Romulus selected 100 men to form the Roman Senate, and then the patricians descended, or kind of were descendants from them, from these 100 men, and then all the plebeians, which was the majority of the Roman society, they weren't given any kind of much privileges at all, because they were just kind of looked at in a low manner. You know, they treated them as just kind of minor workers doing stuff, and they weren't allowed to wear togas, and they didn't have any kind of citizen privileges or anything. So yeah, they're just a, you know, so someone so kind of makes sense that they would just be kind of dropped in, kind of created, and they could, you know, kind of be the foundation of the Roman Empire.
So I have this picture that someone sent me that they got in a museum, and I haven't really researched it. And there's probably a name or a title to it, and I don't know if we're going to be able to. Maybe we need to research it before. I want to put it in the video so people can take a look at it, but when I looked at this image, and I'm going to place this for you to see, and you can take a look at what you think. They told me that this was the mix of Draco Pleiadian. And if you notice, supposedly this is in a Slovenian museum, as someone told me. And I thought that was quite...
Gee, that's creepy.
It's pretty creepy, and I've seen this before. I have to do take a look, and before we post this, we'll probably have the information. I'm just going to look at what the statement was. A Roman statue. It's in a National Museum, Roman Times area. Let's see if there's anything else. Nope. I don't know what it's called, but it's very... If you look at the muscle, it seems to have more muscles than... humans would normally have.
More cuts,
extremely cut. There's absolutely no body fat. And because the Pleiadians seem to not really, you don't really notice the muscle tone on the Pleiadians, but the Dracos are very, very muscular, kind of, you know, kind of reptoid species. And, you know, you can see this, like, defined-looking body structure. That, and then, of course, the face. It's very eerie. I think what they were showing is that someone had an awareness of their presence. And tried to reveal what this was. Maybe they even actually had dreams or kind of a sense or an awareness of what this is. I'm going to have to take a look and get the name of it. But we will have something posted during the you know, so you can look at the links and take a look at this. So that to me, they told me that this was one of the plebeians, what they look like if it's stripped down without the human facade.
Okay. Yeah, I get that.
Yeah. So, I mean, you wouldn't see them walking around like this, but maybe people would have, a bit of a hint of it, you know. And by them working physically all the time, it was probably quite evident. But like you said, there's a little bit too many muscles on there to look like a normal human muscular structure.
Yeah. And what else was there? I don't know. It was because when you call up plebeians on kind of Wiki or on Google Maps, you just get that kind of classic ancient Roman face.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of hardy, kind of earthy look, you know?
Yeah, like kind of like the way that, you know, the working class blue-collar guys looked, you know, or... And what was interesting is he said that these hybrids were very interested in having their own breakaway societies all the time, feeling disempowered and wanting to do their own thing. And, like, they weren't necessarily inside of Rome, right? They kind of had their own space.
Mm.
But yet they were subservient. You know, they were definitely subservient to the Romans, but they kind of knew why they were there and what they were supposed to do. But the other part was that I don't know if they were kind of hinting like they were whether they were Amish or like kind of like the Quakers or something like that as well, where they still had, you know, the kind of leanings towards the religion part of it that the Pleiadians seem to like. And then at the same token, they were great builders. They could sustain, you know, very difficult weather, like they came over to New England and they were extremely hardy, whereas, you know, some other groups had a hard time coming over here. The weather was difficult, and if you weren't prepared for it, there were going to be, you know, some kind of problems. You definitely needed some form of shelter and some knowledge about building, you know, to create something that's it's different for the people that were, you know, like the native people that were from here, that they already understood and how to protect themselves. But as far as, you know, a lot of building these farms and some of the bigger structures, a lot of that stuff came from these early breakaway religious groups. And so also, you know, I can't help but think of the Mormons, you know, how they traveled across, had this, you know, spiritual experience related to Joseph Smith and all that, and they were very hardy, and they had not much of a problem with Native people. It seems like they kind of were able to do exactly what they needed to do, and they were able to be strong enough to travel and then build and you know, really create some stuff. So, I mean, and this is not to point out those people. I'm not saying that all the people are plebeians, or they were all, you know, had Draco, Pleiadian, but it does make me wonder, you know, because this is new information for me right now, and we have, our Earth is influenced by many different species, so I don't know.
There's truly a melting pot.
Right, there's more of a melting pot than we realize, in my opinion. So, and from what Meetis is saying here. So anyhow,
I think that's good. Yeah, fascinating, yeah.
Yeah, and we can always, you know, bring it up if there's a point that you were, you know, didn't come to your thoughts, you know, we can always bring that up in the process. So let's go to Rhodan.
I remember the seas, the dark and mysterious seas of time. They are filled with many wonders and many secrets. There are things hidden there by the many species who have visited your planet for over 100,000 years. It is said one can hear the whispers of their voices if you tune into the right frequency and listen to the echoes of time. There are 30 gates of time channels in the Earth's waters alone. Yet there is even more, but if you cannot understand this concept, then it will be senseless to inform you of more detail. With the advent of human exploration beyond the survival efforts of societies and territorial conflicts, humans began to look beyond themselves into the quest of explaining what had happened on Earth that caused many different things to happen, both good and bad. Your history is the key to many understandings, but when altered, it can persuade an entire generation to be lulled back to sleep. Your dependence on human belief systems or systems that end in destructions, such as the worship of dark entities who have no life to give or future to promise other than to gather you whole and consume you, bring you into their forsaken worlds. We watch how some of you are learning. They are testing and trying all truths, and they are beginning to see beyond the veil of lies. Look deeper, my friends. Don't stop there. I see you had a battle with Mengele and Reinhardt. They have been watching and shadowing you for a long time, as well as many of the children who were with you in the Mylab of the Murkoff group. It was a place of poison to your young minds, but your hearts were pure and you survived it. They created stories and lies that were meant to pit you against each other. But this tactic was useless. They claimed to be formidable, but had many, many weaknesses.
They preyed upon children. How would they imagine that they achieved anything worthy of achievement? They lifted themselves as great scientists, but instead they were nasty child abusers preying on the young and innocent minds of children. Now let them see how they do with us as adults. Not so well.
You had approached your nightmares and turned the tables upon them. This is something they were not expecting.
The time-traveling Nazi, Reinhardt Heydrich, kept showing up in many of my visions. The first time I saw him traveling, he came up from the 1940s or 50s into New York City through a manhole on one of the streets in the city. Then I saw a high-rise building where they were meeting in present day. And just recently, I saw a desert where I saw Mengele sitting on a jump seat and surrounded by parched earth. His head was slumped over as if he was strained by the travel. And his eyes were closed, looking down. His shoulders were slouched over, and then I saw Reinhardt just appear, standing in front of him. They worked together, gathering information, controlling different things in the future. Mengele told many children that he was their father. He was not their father, but he tricked them to trust him.
This part is now over. There are still others. But this part of the nightmare is now gone. We are reaching out to you to protect many who are trying to be released from the grips of many groups who have coordinated with the MyLab of Canada. Don't be discouraged. Press on and continue to assist and help along the way. The waters are doing strange things to people. The Russian submarine brought in a possession of a dark one that caused the mission to be in suicide. One of them went berserk, a former Viking of the past, who was triggered by the energy, but had recognized the energy from the waters of the deep. Don't be alarmed. These are the tactics that the entities will do to retain power over land and sea. They don't care that human life is being compromised in the process. Hold on. We are with you.
Okay, so let's take a look at Rhodan. He begins by talking about the sea. Talks about the mysteries of the sea and the wonders and their many secrets. And he's reminding us that we still don't know a lot about what's going on there. He said there are things that are hidden there by many species, not one, but many, that have visited your planet over 100,000 years. So we have mysteries from over 100,000 years in our oceans right now. And he said that one can hear the whispers of their voices if you tune into the right frequency and listen to the echoes of time. So in essence, they have a presence there that is still retrievable. And if brought to a certain location, something can happen. So he says there are 30 gates of time channels in the Earth's waters alone. Yet there's even more. But if you cannot understand this concept, then it would be senseless to inform you of more detail. So he's trying to help us to build upon the understanding of how things have been working over preceding our existence here on the Earth. With the advent of human exploration beyond the survival efforts of societies and territorial conflicts, humans began to look beyond themselves into the quest of explaining what has happened on the Earth. So it's essentially where, you know, people are just trying to figure out who they are in each incarnation. They're also, you know, very territorial, trying to interact with those around them. And then once they get all that settled in, they begin feeling comfortable You know, we have a lot of civilizations that did not look into the history of their own people because they all retained that knowledge. And they weren't so concerned about all the other civilizations. And of course, there were some that were trying to figure out, particularly they had these conflicts and, you know, tribes traveling in and creating wars and, you know, searching for other land because for whatever reason, maybe their land wasn't as fertile anymore. Or, you know, they were just trying to find, there was an expansion and growth of the population of a certain family lineage that kind of expanded out and grows. And then, of course, this travel and so forth that starts happening. So he's saying, you know, essentially what, you know, over time, the early history of humanity, we spent a lot of time just growing and expanding and developing territories. But then as, you know, humanity started to get older as a race, or at least this revolution of humanity, they started to think about, you know, hey, wait a minute, we're losing our history, or, you know, it keeps on getting taken from us, as we feel presently that, you know, they want us to forget a lot of what happened. But there is this idea, this longing or exploration to kind of find out where we came from or what we've evolved into or what kind of experiences that we keep going through, or that someone's deliberately altering our history. And so there's this frustration, so we keep on looking back and trying to figure things out. And Rhodan's reminding us something that we might have known had we not had much of this memory loss and it was carried on through generations, is that there is, we've had multiple visitations from off-world, and that presence was in the waters. And so the waters become very tricky. So some people see the depths of the ocean almost like a type of hell. And it could be if it's interacting with the wrong species. So he said that there's these 30 gates or time channels. And channels meaning frequency channels where you could actually tune in if the right circumstances around it. And as you have advanced technology now, or these very advanced type of submarines and ships and going into the waters, and it's probably allowing them to access these other frequencies where they could actually tune in to these dimensional shifts of frequencies or accessing some of these gates, which is creating other types of influences. So then he says that we see that you're learning. And they're testing and trying all truths. Let's see. What you want to do is beginning to see beyond the veil of lies. And so looking within yourself, you have to do your own personal work. If you want to be able to have a better determination of what's going on around you. And ultimately, you can't just take anyone's word. You really have to have a sense of your own knowing. And so he's encouraging that. He says, look deeper. Don't stop there. So he's encouraging everyone to do their own personal work. And that's awakening your senses, awakening your third eye, and having a sense of, you know, your own path. And then he mentions to me about this battle that I had with Mengele and Reinhardt, primarily because they kept on coming up. And, you know, a group of people that I've been working with, you know, that there was this very strong presence. And it literally got scary. It really, really got scary because it's probably related to this Fifth Reich. I don't, you know, how the ACIO does categorize them and the different levels that they're at. But I will say that I know that I was directed by the Council of Five to look into this and to try to help release a lot of people that feel that they have been influenced by this group, Murkoff group in my lab that's up in Canada, and discovery that some of them were seeing that Mengele was calling them his child, and which is very strange. It's actually a way of getting the children to open up to him. And so there's like a distinct memory of seeing him, recognizing him. And actually, in some cases, unfortunately, some of the people had to relive this through whether it was a regression or a memory or vision that they had, that it was coming through very clearly, and it was very upsetting to them, and very upsetting to everyone involved, including myself, because of course I was part in that experience. And then when I saw Reinhardt showing up, where I saw that parched earth, and it was kind of like a future reality where Mengele was there sitting in a jump seat, his head kind of slumped over, like partially unconscious, but, you know, seems to have an awareness when Reinhardt goes to meet him there. And what's weird is he's not in a jump seat. He's able to freely try and time travel, which was very strange. And I also saw that he, I had been seeing him. The only reason I recognized him, I went searching for him the first time I saw him come up out of the manhole, and I actually saw him walking down corridors in places in New York City. And I think he had an awareness that I was seeing him. So he hasn't made things easy for me. And I definitely had some major conflict with him. And recently there was another conflict where I actually caught him again. She doesn't like, no one likes to be caught, of course. But I caught him again, and he was, this is the whole time traveling Nazi thing that I've been talking about for years. And so he was, like I said, he shows up in this place, and I could see him and Mengele have these agreements. That and whatever the ultimate agenda was, but they were doing stuff in the future to pretty much leverage us, you know, throughout time. And so the way that the earth looks so parched, I mean, I'm talking like huge cracks in the ground that might have had water on it at one time, but was so depleted of water that there was, I don't know, maybe like a foot deep of like crevices and cuts. It was throughout, as far as I could see. I couldn't see anything that was growing. And I don't know how far in the future that was. So we're talking from the 1940s and then jumping way ahead into the future. And so Rhodan was mentioning that he saw that I had this experience, and that you know, I was trying to reach out and help people in the process. And them recalling things, which is also bringing forth a lot of the information that is liberating, and to help people to get disentangled and liberated finally. Then Rhodan brings up this most recent incident. Well, of course, like I said, he says, don't be discouraged regarding this MyLab in Canada. Press on and continue to assist and help along the way. So he's saying we're in the right direction. We're doing the right thing. Then he mentions about the waters. He says the waters are doing strange things to people. And he said this Russian submarine thing that I had the problems with, I was psychically connected to them. They didn't harm me. People were concerned for me, and I appreciate that, but I just want to let everyone know I wasn't getting harmed. I had an awareness of their presence, and I was getting psychically attacked, which means that they was feeling bombarded emotionally, and they were saying things to me and threatening me and doing all sorts of stuff, and that coincided with this event. Now, it felt like it was very close. Everyone, you know, according to the news, the submarine was over in the Russian waters. But I'll tell you, it felt close. So I know that people believe what the news says, and there's verifications for different things or whatever. But why was I feeling that? sometimes I trust my own feelings that there is something else going on that they don't include, and they usually don't include that. And it's still, I'm not 100% sure that I actually believe that they were over there, but I don't want to argue with people. And if people feel that it was over in the other waters, then that's their choice. But it felt like it was pretty close, to be honest with you. So anyhow, one of the things that he said was there was it was a suicide mission, primarily because one became very possessed by an entity in the water, And here again, someone might disagree and say, well, the news said that this happened, and that's fine. You know, your choice, your belief. And this is what Rodan's saying, is that it started off with some type of possession, something in the water, and an ET of some sort possessed one of them. Another one had a lifetime connected to the Vikings, so it got into a berserker mode a bit, being triggered by the energy, and then it created these other problems. So that's pretty much what he said. And he said, don't be alarmed. These are tactics that the entities will do to retain power over the land and sea. They don't care that human life is being compromised in the process. But, you know, the good thing is they know when these things are happening, and they're really holding back a lot of issues. So the entities will stir things up, kind of like, you know, stirring up the hornet's nest and trying to see if anyone reacts to it. And because I don't think that either group wants to see the Earth just go up in explosions and destroy the planet. I think everyone is trying to be careful and cautious, but there is definitely some manipulations that are going on, and these are the entities. Like I said, as far as they're concerned, if we get wiped out, it doesn't affect them in any negative way. It allows them to pretty much take the planet as their own and do whatever they want with it. That's the dystopian experience. Wouldn't affect them in any negative way at all. They would be perfectly fine with it. So these are the type of things that, you know, well, we can look at. And this is the type of stuff that they're trying to settle down a bit. So anyhow, Ian, anything that you want to share about Rhodan?
Yeah, the the time traveling Nazis. When you see them, is it interdimensionally, or is it astrally, or are they kind of in and out of time? So they to satisfy their agendas.
I mean, it's like they're misplaced. It's like, you know, here I am. I'm looking. I'm literally like what some would say remote viewing, but I wasn't intending to look at that space. It just shows up. It's almost like there's something in me that is drawn to an anomaly, and my higher self or whatever just opens right up to that space. There's something off. It's like a radar of some sort. And then before you know it, I'm looking, and here's this person from another timeline coming up through a manhole, obviously, you know, jumped in the space. Now, I'm not finding every single time traveler that's doing this, but something was significant to this. And what I think it is that they were hooked into me as a child, you know, because they brought me into these my labs. And also because I probably knew them when I was manipulated into being a part of the Vril. And so they hooked into me that way. And so here I am, you know, probably tuning into what they're doing as they were kind of hooked into me.
Yeah.
So maybe in some way, yeah, it's kind of.
You're a pathway back to them kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. But they, what's happening is when he went into New York. It was a couple of years ago, and I talked about it on the Andronicus Transmissions. I literally watched him, and I was like, I've seen him before. He looked back at me, and he was running down like a hallway, and then it cut to another scene where I saw him come up through the manhole and looking around, and no one notices him. And then it went to another scene where I saw him go up into this high-rise building. And it's like they had the whole floor, and they were all like part of this time traveler group, and that was in New York City. And so this one looked like it was, I'm not really sure. I want to say it's a southwest, but it looks really dry, like abnormally dry. So, like, because, you know, I've seen a bit of the desert in, like, California in that area, you know. But it looked really parched, and I'm not really sure. Maybe there is a location on the Earth. Someone wants to send me a picture, and I can confirm it in the comments below. But it's hard because I get so much information coming in, almost like I can't. I'd be 24/7 looking for data and other things to build all this information. And if I stop to go back and research everything, there's other things that need help. So I have to use that energy to keep on helping what's coming along as it's unfolding and happening. So you have this Nazi thing that's opening up, and then all of a sudden there's these earthquakes. So then, yeah. You know, you have to focus on what's going on with the earthquakes that's happening right around the same time that this thing is opening up to me. So is it connected? Very likely.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so the MyLabs had an intention by bringing these, you know, all the children in and to trigger them and get them to be working for their agenda, you know, unintentionally, because they usually have some kind of old lineage connection to something, or, you know, some of these people that were related to this Atlantean thing, which I'm going to share with at some time when it's the right time. And it's interesting in my book, The Seer, Violets in the Grass, I talk about Atlantis rising in I think it's the last chapter. And so you have all of these things that are sort of, you know, they had me write about around, you know, 2011, 2012, and a lot of this stuff is starting to become more obvious to me. But I think... right now, it's pivotal, and so, like I said, and I'm not closed-minded to anyone's views as long as it's not, like, just negative to be negative. And people have some very interesting ideas and contributions. And as far as I'm concerned, like I said, it's a group effort of kind of understanding, awakening, and it's all about that, more so than anyone, you know, just knowing things, which is somewhat, you know, I don't know. It seems pointless to me. One person knows stuff, and then everyone's waiting to hear one person talk. You know, it's not about that at all.
No. It's amazing the amount of information coming out now about these projects, these MyLabs and the Montauk and the MKUltra and everything. The whole thing, I don't know when it was, I think, it became I became aware of projects like the Montauk experiment back in 92 with the Preston Nichols books that he wrote with Peter Moon.
Yeah.
About the Montauk, and then only recently I've been getting into a couple of series on Netflix, and it's really bizarre. The one's called Dark, and it's about time travel in an American it's a German series, but it's overdubbed into English, and it's about a secret society that has been traveling in time, manipulating time and affecting this village that are living in a 33-year cycle. And it's a little bit daunting. This, you know, it's it can be a bit challenging to watch, but it was kind of really interesting. And so that's kind of manipulation of time. And
yeah,
then there's
hold on before you go any further. Did you say 33?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that just came up today. I had a session with someone, and she says the number 33 just keeps coming up, and she was a part of these projects.
Yeah.
So that must be the 33 cycle. That makes sense.
Some kind of soft disclosure, yeah.
Wow. All right. I did see that series, Dark, and I wasn't. Now, of course, I don't have time to watch TV a lot. So, but yeah.
It was interesting and actually quite a complex plot. It's quite hard to follow.
Yeah, well, that's deliberate.
it's kind of not only in current time, but it's like it's in 2019. Then some of the characters go back 33 years, some go back earlier, and some stay there and grow up, and they're actually in 2019, but different characters from when they were born, and the whole thing gets enmeshed, and it's really tricky to keep a track on. But that's, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of these series, but then the next one I was watching was more of a kind of, it's called Stranger Things. I don't know if you've seen that one. But yeah, that's about it starts off in this village in this town in the States, and a young girl escapes from a my lab,
mm-hmm.
and the whole story develops, and it's kind of got like a Mengele character in it as well, and they've created exactly like in the Montauk projects, like a rift in time, and a monster came through, and they don't know how to deal with a monster. And so that's the plot. But there's a group of children who are kind of involved in it. And again, that's worth watching if you kind of like that thing. It's a bit, I think that's a bit more horror as well in it. But both of those series, they're kind of very current with the, it's like soft disclosure and kind of a way of making it, if you like, normalizing it, really, which you should never really be.
Well, I have something to say about Stranger Things. That show came out when I was living in Newburyport, which one of the primary stars is from Newburyport, one of the boys.
Okay.
And the people that I knew that I was renting from, one of their sons knew him.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been saying this for years. I feel like I'm telling my stories. They're taking some of the stories and the information that I have because they knew the stuff that I did. And then suddenly they become a show or a movie somewhere and they don't even give me credit. It's like, come on. Are you kidding me? I mean, it was so close. Now, I'm not saying that I could prove that they actually did, but isn't it strange?
Yeah.
Isn't it odd that these people all knew each other? I'm in the same town, and suddenly, you know, this kid's in the movie, and he's from that town, and these kids know exactly what I do. You know, I was very open about some of the things that were happening and disclosure and so forth, and suddenly this series comes out.
Mm. It's kind of like everything, isn't it? You know, there's these kind of atrocities and real life experiments, then a whole kind of sci-fi series gets a spin-off from it.
Yeah, of course. And you know, it's good in a way because then all of a sudden people start saying, hey, maybe that could happen because it's on TV. You know, I mean, they hear us talking about it and they say, you know, you people are storytellers, you're liars, you're this and that. And, you know, I mean, I know I had a really hard time on James Rink's show. And, you know, a lot of different people come on and they'll still talk about, you know, similar things that they see on YouTube. So now they got the story down. They know exactly what to say. And then people say, oh, yeah, we know that's true because we heard this like probably through four or five different people on YouTube already. So when they're talking about it, they must be telling the truth. No, they're just repeating what they heard others say. So you get, you know, people like that. And then when you say something that no one's ever talked about, like the stuff that Peter and I've talked about, then we're lying or we're making it up. So, you know, because, you know, they need to hear it for about, you know, from a bunch of either certain people that they have some kind of trust belief in, you know, and what they're saying. And then there's, but for most part, that's why people doing disclosure keep going back to the same type of topics and information that's somewhat familiar so that people don't think that they're not telling the truth, but it's not always current. So they don't, even like, you know, 20 years down the road, they're still talking about this. It's kind of the same stuff, but that's to keep people listening and verifying. And then those that kind of go off and talk about some of the newer stuff. And then there's a lot of, like, you know, ridicule. And so, which it does is it's designed that way, or it's kind of in our heads that way, so that people are not open to the possibility of some of this other information. It's almost like you have to go through this struggle of trying to reveal this stuff. So in some ways, it's good that it's on television, because then they start saying, oh, so your crazy, wild stories, you know, there they are. They're on television. They took the stories. And, you know, some of them, because they're like Monarch and Mobius are making these movies and, you know, creating these games, they're actually exposing what they're doing. And that's another hard part for people to realize, that they're actually doing their own self-disclosure.
Mm-hmm. Haven't they discovered that, I think, advertisers have, you know, there's a science behind this. Although the human consciousness can't take in new concepts straight away. They have to see, I think advertisers know, they have to see something advertised a large number of times. I don't know what the exact number is, but it's a high number before that they would want to buy something.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's like, I don't know the figure, but it's quite a high figure. And they need to see it all those times. Each time they need to see the advert. And then after a certain time, it becomes part of them. You know, they've absorbed it, and then they can buy the product. So I guess the same kind of thing applies. Yeah?
Yes, but all right, so let's consider this. If people are awakened, they're going to remember some of this stuff, particularly those that were actually in the My Labs, are going to remember certain things, certain stories. There'll be more than one.
Mm.
And I've had that happen over and over again, where a few different people that are completely unrelated all saying the same thing. I mean, how do you orchestrate that? You can't. It has to be, it exists somewhere. So when some of the stuff is getting disclosed, there's elements of memory that would be there if a person has an awakened state of mind, and they would find some of it familiar. So that groundwork is already laid. Because there's nothing new here that's being spoken of, even though that it's new disclosure. But the disclosure comes out incrementally according to what humans are ready to hear. And even if you don't get it, like when I do a private session, sometimes people say, well, I don't really fully get it. And then months later, they're like, oh my God, now it totally makes sense to me. I know what you're talking about. And so it has to sink in a bit.
Starts of a chain reaction.
Yeah, yeah. But I think, I'm not saying that, you know, saying anything about what anyone should be doing. I mean, it's their choice. But I'm saying how hard it is to get the information out, because you know that there's going to be some kind of reaction every time you do it. And it gets, it's not a pleasant experience, I'll just say that. I mean, it doesn't get me that upset. But it's almost like an anticipation that someone's going to say some really negative stuff. And you're like, well, you know, what's the point if I'm saying it and they're not receiving it? And then I think, well, whatever, there are enough people that appreciate the information and it actually validates some of the experiences they're going through. So then they know and have a better understanding, because it's worse when you're getting attacked or things are happening and you don't understand what the origin is. I mean, I know some people that were right on the edge, and some of this information really helped them get through, because then they realized that they weren't the only one experiencing it. And so then they no longer felt isolated. They no longer felt like they were crazy. They never, you know, I mean, it helped them tremendously. So in that case, you know, it's worth it to share the information.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. But thank you for sharing that information about 33. So that's going to be interesting. I'm going to have my friend take a listen. And
And going back, if I can just kind of draw out some more information about the submarine, there's been a number of different stories and a number of different kind of people have spoken about different things. I'd listened to Simon Parks' podcast, the recent one. I was listening to like a little bit of that today, and this submarine thing was a major issue, yeah? And the story that goes around was there's a fire and they were trying to bring the fire under control, and like a number of submariners died kind of putting the fire out, fighting the fire. Simon Parks was talking about that for a short time that submarine was taken over by the cabal. Well, that's the impression that people were getting. Yeah. And so that's why no one offered any help. And all the different countries, they all had kind of straight away, they had emergency meetings in all the countries about this situation. So was it that there was a walk-in that took over the submarine?
It could appear that it was the cabal, but yeah, it was, you have to realize there's entities that live in the water, that live in our oceans.
I was thinking that maybe, the cabal are kind of, I think, made up of a number of species, and they perhaps could have the capability of walking into some of kind of walking into one of the admirals or whatever on the submarine, because this was a special kind of submarine. It's a submarine that could go to very deep depths, more than any. Well, I think the US have got the same, but it was a very kind of small but deep depth one. And so going down to such depths in such situations, I'm sure this kind of thing could happen more, couldn't it, you know? So a person became, what did you say, the Russian submarine brought in a possession of a dark one that caused the mission to be in suicide. So perhaps like a number of people were taken over by this dark entity, and it turned into a suicide, you know, and then they lost, you know, the Russians lost control of that submarine, and it was going to be like, it was going to be an attempt to set off World War III or something.
Right. I mean, just think of it this way. I mean, I've interacted with people and I've been in haunted spaces where you can have paranormal anywhere. You could be sitting in a house and things start banging and whatever. And that's, you know, that's something entering into the dimensional space. Mm. I've been in that situation multiple times. I've gone into haunted spaces. I've helped people that were in a haunted situation and, you know, things knocking on, you know, they're on an upper level of a building and the balcony window, someone's knocking on the balcony window, but there's no one there, you know, that kind of weird stuff that you can't explain. And, you know, this just happens. And so imagine you're underwater and one of those things steps into the space.
Yeah.
And because now I'm thinking that the fire was mayhem.
Yeah. Cause it must, you know, it's a very confined space anyway, but are the pressures that the craft is under and the powers that we're not totally aware of at those levels, you know, there's a lot can happen. And I was also reading another alternative press magazine about it. And he said that I don't know if this is genuine or not, but they said that the Russian submarine radioed kind of just before the incident and said, we're in the hornet's nest, which is very similar to what you said, wasn't it?
Yeah, I never heard that in the article. That's interesting. That's exactly what Rhodan said.
Yeah, he said that we're in the hornet's nest.
Mm-hmm.
And then everything kind of happened.
Yeah. See, Rhodan knows. They know that these things have been living under the waters. I mean, we know more about the moon in Mars than we know about what's under our waters. Because the waters scare the hell out of people. They go down in there and they have these really strange experiences because there are creatures there that are living way underneath. And he says for 100,000 years there's been species going underwater, and they've found crafts and all sorts of things underneath the water, some different kinds of structures. And it looks like they're abandoned, but, I mean, do you really want to try to pull up and see who's actually in there? I mean, think of it. It's the fear of the unknown, and, I mean, it's almost just as unnerving as going to another planet. But because the water is very unpredictable, the temperature of the water, I mean, it's within minutes, if not seconds, how fast someone can die in those circumstances, especially with the pressure, you know, as being a part of the issue.
And also I was wondering, would the psychic protection that perhaps you will get from your group or individually, would that be weakened by kind of putting your body through such, you know, working at such unusual limits? Maybe the kind of, it's easier to do this kind of thing, you know?
By going underwater, I almost drowned before underwater. I mean, I just, you know, I remember that as a kid. And me and probably thousands of other people, anyone that lives near the ocean and you're young and you go swimming. And like I said, there's something about the water that is highly unpredictable. And you almost have to have this real affinity for the water and have this, you know, very... athletic, you know, someone that very, very experienced to deal with the water. And even the fishermen and all that, they have a reverence to what goes on in the oceans. And because at any moment, whether it's in the water or any weather pattern, you know, it becomes dangerous very quickly. And so that is because of it's like a living storm, you know, the whole thing moves, it's a whole body, it has momentum, it has power, can take out whole cities, and there are things living there, and it's not just fish. So you have extraterrestrials. I mean, they've had sightings off of California, I think it's San Diego, I could be wrong, but I think around that area where we've talked about, there's actually, you know, civilization underwater, and that's throughout. People have seen that there's a civilization underneath Cuba in the waters. There's, of course, I've talked to someone personally who visits Puerto Rico yearly and said that he would go to a certain location and sit there and watch spaceships go in and out of the water there. So, I mean, these are things that a lot of people you know, have an awareness about. And so, you know, Rhodan's just reminding us that these things can happen. And also, they would be very happy. Some of them would be very happy if there would not be any humans on the Earth. I mean, humans are doing some things. They're messing around with frequencies. There's a lot of ships that are doing things underneath the water. And so to create a World War III would be nothing for them. So it doesn't have to be the cabal, it could be any other type of species that's living under the water that's feeling disrupted, or, you know,
or with dark agendas or whatever.
There's a lot of things, you know. We're not the only ones here.
No.
And we're supposed to be caretakers of the planet, not destructive to the planet. We're not supposed to be destructive to each other, and because we do have the forces of nature itself, just the actual flow of water and the way that the earth is and everything, it does have, as powerful as it is, it still is fragile in a lot of ways and can't be set off. And so even though some of these species may be quite negative, like a cabal or something like that's just trying to manipulate things and create a war, but there could be some that are just saying, you know, pay attention to what you're doing here.
Yeah.
You know, you don't have the right to do some of the things that you're doing and compromise their situation.
That's which it.
They might have permission to be here too.
Yeah. What you're doing in our hood, 6,000 meters below sea level.
Yeah. And I think this happens more often than people realize. I suppose that you could have a military person here that deals with submarines and could probably tell you quite a few stories.
I'll bet.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what happens. But I do know that there were, whatever it was, like I said, I was like at first getting psychically attacked. I was pretty close to the water. Actually not far from what's called Seabrook. And there's actually a big power plant there, by the way, for some of the people that want to look at the geography of it. It's very coastal, and I was like in the store walking around and just getting bombarded, you know, threatening me, saying stuff. And I'm like, geez, I don't even know what this is. You know, who is this? And, you know, like, and I go into another store, and then it kept going. And then I don't know if I suppressed it, but then it was sort of in the background. And I don't know what it was when I saw that Marfugel, and that's when this special report that I created about the Marfugel report. And all of a sudden I said that I knew it was related to that and what he was bringing up.
Because that submarine as well, that is one that's used to go down so deep to find things that have been there for a long time and kind of pick up interesting items and things like that, you know? So It's kind of anyone's guess.
They can, you know, they can take someone that is going on a mission, even someone that goes to like the moon or even there's certain regions on the earth that are kind of like weird and people go there and like, or like the Bermuda Triangle, and you get a little too close to something, or if you see something or have an awareness of something, they'll mess you up. They'll have you disoriented. They'll mess with your timeline. They'll mess with your memory. They'll really screw you up, and you'll come out of there, and you won't, if they don't kill you, you know, and you'll wonder what in the world just happened to me here. It's because you didn't get permission to go to that space. Mm. You saw something you weren't supposed to see. It's really tricky, and I'm not trying to bring fear to anyone, but I mean, you hear about these weird stories, you know, and that's what it is. They don't like to be observed. They don't want anyone to know that they're there. They don't want spectators. And even like those that are coming here, they're not supposed to be here. They don't want to be seen.
Mm.
So it's kind of a weird, it's a weird thing, but I think that, like I said, there's a mutual respect. That's why when I did ghost hunting, I kind of got frustrated because I would tell people, you know, be careful what you're doing. You're bringing, you know, there's definitely a really bad entity there. Oh, no, this is just, you know, that's not science what you're talking about. It's not real. And I'll never forget this guy, you know, big 6 foot, or was like 6 foot two or whatever height, even big guy. He's like, yeah, we'll see what happens. You know, I told him there was something really bad in the room. And I mean, he screamed like a girl. I mean, you know, like, and I'm not saying that sexist in any way. I'm just saying that he was scared. He was scared. That thing grabbed a hold of his throat, lifted him up, and he had scratch marks in his neck. It was all red, and he couldn't see it. And anything like that, I don't care how big you are, how strong you are, whatever, you see something like that come at you, and it's pretty dangerous, and it's hard for me to work with people that don't listen or just kind of like you know, blow something off, and then I feel somewhat responsible. So I feel like, well, if I don't do it, then I'm not responsible for what happens to that person, even though they made that choice. I don't want to be associated with it, but this stuff is very real, and fortunately, and can be dangerous if it's not handled in the right way. You know, you have to communicate and understand what's in the space and why they're there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess we really went off on this topic. Maybe it will help somebody. Maybe we needed to. So, all right. We got a few more. So we got some other stuff that came up too, didn't we? Let's go to Andronicus.
Where there is peace of mind, there will be a way. This is the reason why I separated myself from all things. I can then think clearly through it all. This is the reason why I suggested meditation to form a clarity within ourselves, to see beyond illusions in our own lives, then be able to help others further. We have not come to you as leaders. It benefits humanity to lead themselves. If your perception is blind, then how can the blind lead others? It is worth it all if humanity comes to realize the many hidden mysteries and truths within themselves, to be able to determine the truth or the lies beyond yourselves. Freedom is the choice to see things clearly and be able to determine your own destiny. Make your own decisions and follow your heart, wherever it may lead. I have helped you amongst others who have helped you with issues that were beyond your control. Many beings have incarnated as humans. In the process of incarnation, they have brought predatory and invasive species, networks of systems, ancient forms of AI, creatures beyond imaginations, collectives of civilizations long gone but retained within a field, higher species and hybrids that introduce new problems. It all seems never-ending, but is coming more into transparency. The arachnid species from Mars was introduced onto the planet by secret space programs and your Montauk project on Mars. The arachnid queen went back to space and time to harness the thoughts and control of humanity. We have recently removed this invasive parasite from your planet. Some of humanity embraced it as a type of mother, but there was nothing benevolent about it. It was a parasitic species, and regardless of its influence on the minds of humanity, it always resulted in depletions of soul essence and even the electromagnetic flora of the brain, where humans would then open to a type of zombieism. I am disheartened to inform you of this strangeness, but feel it necessary for you to not be blind to the problems. We do not blame humanity for exploring to other regions, but this also explains why humans keep falling vulnerable to such beings who claim higher knowledge and godhood reign over you. There is a deeper lack of discretion and discernment. This is truly the issue above all the rest. You are destined to travel. You are curious beings who are here to learn about yourselves, your surroundings, the world, and space exploration as well. This was all intended for you. Likewise, the exploration on your moon brought in other invasive species such as the Greys and others. With knowledge, you will be better prepared for the galactic community.
So this explains why the Montauk group had so many problems. Would you say that they were manipulated by this arachnid species?
Yes, very much so. She had them fighting amongst each other, suspicious and competitive. They tried to succeed, but didn't know or had lost their true inner guidance. This then brought in many other species who also wanted to handle and abuse them in their own, in their vulnerable state, due to the difficulty of what their bodies endured in travel, as well as the emotional part that caused further trauma. The humans behind the projects were not all evil, though. Some were highly influenced in the earlier part of the experiments. There is so much more to discuss about this topic, but it may put others in harm's way to get too deep into the discussion. My intention is for those to see through what is happening around you and don't take anything at face value. We are here to help you to further your freedom of exploration as opposed to invasion. Be well, my friends.
Oh, wait. Can I ask about Hans Left, whom I spoke to recently, and he said he was Andromedan and spoke similar to some of your earlier transmissions.
Ah, yes. He finally broke through the barrier. They didn't want him to see what they were doing. Yes, he is part of a sensitive investigation team that was sent to your planet. The Palladians were there waiting for him, and one was there specifically to confuse everyone by calling him Hans Right. They were in search of the Vinkala, the reptilian species you are familiar with. He is with your group helping your planet avoid the nightmare of destruction that they wanted to bring in. You have our consent to share his message with the people.
Okay. So, Andronicus, he starts talking to us about the same topic that I bring up earlier about how people need to go within and start, whether it's meditating or have a sense of knowing on the inside of them. And then he talks about, pretty much realization of many hidden mysteries of truths within themselves. He talks about the predator and invasive species, networks of systems. Many beings are incarnated as humans. In the process of incarnation, they've also brought these realities with them, which are predatory and invasive species. So these things kind of come in through their memory, through their soul history, networks of systems, ancient forms of AI, creatures beyond imagination, collectives of civilizations long gone but retained within a field, hive species, hybrids that introduce then even new problems. It all seems never-ending, but is coming more into transparency. So you're starting to understand how this works, that a soul can actually open up intuitively and even bring in things through themselves, not just through a geographic location or interaction with something on the outside of them, so that some of the stuff can actually open up in a field around them and bring back some of these old experiences, which you could see the complexity of all this and how this can unfold. So then he goes on to talk about how the arachnid species from Mars is introduced into the planet by secret space programs and the Montauk Project. So when they went and traveled to Mars, this arachnid species was there. The queen in particular decided to come back into our space. And then to harness our thoughts and control humanity. I think it looked like it wanted to take on the role of a mother. And so we have a lot of these species claiming this maternal or mother thing over us. And that's why it's very confusing or muddied regarding who is the Gaia. Because Gaia was not necessarily, the Earth was not Gaia. Gaia had her own planet. The Earth had, I think the Earth was Terra. So, but then everyone gets into the Sophia, they get, all these other teachings. But, it makes me wonder that this arachnid species probably had another variation of the mother on the planet. And, there's like a reptilian mother variation. I see an Anunnaki one that kind of refers to her as the mother of the planet. There's an AI Gaia that I've seen. There's a lot of different variations. So that's why it's very confusing when people say, well, I'm, channeling Gaia or I know Gaia. And I get nervous. I'm like, well, which one are we talking about? So now I have to look and see where it's going to. And There are some people that are connected to the Gaia that was from, you know, who was a Titan. And then there's, you know, there's, like I said, there's others that are referring to them. There's there was an Esmeralda one that was, it was a new one for me, calling herself Gaia, or calling herself the Mother. And I don't know, it just, it goes on and on. And, you know, you have these earlier civilizations where they're the deities or whatever of that time, and they also have taken on that role of the Great Mother, you know. So anyhow, here we have this arachnid that's doing it, and literally created a network and was, you know, utilizing mind control. So, you know, not only do we have the reptilians or the Vinkala doing mind control, but this species also, and, you know, and each species has their own variation of communication, especially the hive species, which we're familiar with, but not all creatures are hive, but maybe have that, you know, kind of like a, that sort of where we get our monarchy idea from, comes from, you know, some of these species where you have to have a queen of some sort that's the rulership over the rest. So, or a king, or whatever. Anyhow, this thing came in, and some of the effects of it was parasitic, so that means it wasn't necessarily, there was nothing really benevolent, although it gave an illusion of maternal comfort. It had a parasitic effect and influencing the minds of humanity as a result of a depletion of soul essence. It was a pulling for those that probably tuned into it quite a bit and worked on the electronic magnetic flora of the brain. That's the way they said it. Where the humans were the open to a type of zombieism. So maybe some of this was introducing, I don't know, some effect on humanity that's really quite, it sounds like the end result's quite negative. I guess if it was extreme exposure, that's how it could end. And I don't know if that had anything to do with some of the zombie species, other animals that kind of got pulled into that. There's even like zombie ants too, which is kind of weird. So wouldn't be surprised if this arachnid species did that. Now, so you look at the behavior of the species. If you look at the spider itself, and it does have a hypnotic state where someone actually falls into its trap, its web, and, you know, then obviously gets affected and wrapped up and kind of injected with something that, you know, further starts to break down the body. So essentially it's doing that astrally. And so they wanted to remove this. And because I imagine that it was becoming a bigger problem. And let's see. And so then he says that, let's see. So we do not blame humanity for exploring other regions. But this also explains why humans keep falling vulnerable to such beings who claim to have higher knowledge and a godhood reign over them. There's a deeper lack of discretion and discernment. This is truly the issue above all the rest. So it's because we don't know how to discern a lot of different things. You know, has, you know, anything that's shiny and bright, we seem to, you know, kind of open up everything and say, wow, that's amazing. It must be, you know, some divine being. And we need to have much more discretion than that. And it's because of this kind of stuff going on. And it has been going on all along. But I think that the New Age approach to many things is just too naive and too open and revealing and dangerous for ourselves. So let's see. You are destined to travel. You are curious beings who are here to learn about yourselves and your surroundings, the world, and space exploration as well. This was intended for you. Likewise, the exploration on the moon brought in some invasive species such as greys and others. With this knowledge, you'll be prepared for the galactic community. So throughout all these growing pains of trying to figure this stuff out, the end result will be that we'll have a better sense and knowledge of what's going on. And likewise, from our earlier conversation regarding the ocean, it's the same thing. That's a frontier that has yet to be fully explored. And it doesn't make any sense why we're so quick to explore off the planet and not look at our surroundings, because there's a lot we still don't know about what's going on. I asked why the Montauk group had so many problems, and I asked if they were just manipulated by this arachnid spirit species, and Andronicus said very much so. She had them fighting against each other, suspicious, competitive, tried to succeed, but they didn't know or had lost their inner guidance, you know, kind of like, I don't know, wiped their memories, got them confused. You really somehow got deep into their psyche and trying to handle them and so forth. And people could say, well, yeah, but that was from the projects. That was from these people. Well, like I said, different ones get puppeted. And, you know, you look further back and you find that this thing is doing a lot of the damage. And another thing that happened is that it created a lot of, they wanted to handle the humans as well as abuse them in their vulnerable state because of the difficulty of what they endured through time travel. So they took advantage of that and the emotional part of the traumas. The humans behind the projects were not evil, all evil. Some were highly influenced in the earlier part of the experiment. I think it was like levels of hijacking and other things that took place because of opening up into this species through the time travel that you know, it becomes a problem. And then I asked him about this. Hans Left, and this is the name he gave me. His name was Hans Left, and he said he was from an Andromeda group. I just wanted to verify this with Andronicus, which he does. And I'm going to share his message coming up, but I guess what happens is the Pleiadians were waiting for him to arrive, so already had a counterfeit of them called Hans Wright. And so, they were in search. Their mission was to search for the Vinkala, the reptilian species trying to help humanity. And in the beginning of the Andronicus Transmissions, it's all about the story about how the Vinkala came, took over their planet through mind control. And you have, you know, here's this arachnid species, as well as the Vinkala also using mind control. And, you know, we see that the greatest weapon is not obvious in front of us, but it's what is subtle in coming in. And that's the biggest problem that we have. We need to awaken to that. Once we do, I think we'll have a better handle on these things. But he's saying that essentially this group of Andromedans actually broke through. They're here, and they started to get a hold of some of this reptilian species you're familiar with, and they're here to help. So he needed to validate that for me, because this being came through a couple days ago, named Hans, and I wanted to make sure that he was not trying to manipulate or deceive, so I had to get a confirmation. So he says, you have our consent to share this message with the people. Okay. So, Ian.
Yeah. Spiders, they are kind of very popular in our culture, aren't they? Okay, not so popular, but they're always used as because a lot of people have got an aversion to spiders.
Yeah, and the arachnophobia.
Yeah. And they're often used, I think for good reason, really, isn't it? Yeah, I think there's something deeper than just an eight-legged thing crawling about.
I think they generally, they generally have a purpose here. The ones that we have here on the Earth, you know, have a purpose. This is like, think of it this way. It's an extraterrestrial version of the species that's not supposed to be here, was on Mars.
Yeah, and I'm guessing they're bigger.
Yeah, I believe they're a lot bigger.
And kind of more developed, more more controlling psychically and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I was trying to think of the films and TV series with giant spiders, and I could think of Lord of the Rings, Harry Potter.
Mm-hmm.
There was a recent Doctor Who episode that had an outbreak of giant spiders. So it seems to be kind of fairly common in our culture, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's in our consciousness, conscious awareness of their presence, you know?
Yeah. So it's something you push aside, but it's there in the background.
Yeah.
So Hans left. Does he give? Is he going to communicate with you in the future, do you think?
I don't know. I know that, you know, I was doing a private session for someone, and then all of a sudden he came in, and the person, you know, was open to allowing him to share the information. And so I channeled whatever he was saying, and it was very, very similar to some of the earlier transmissions from Andronicus, and it might be, you know, kind of their language or the way that they communicate with one another. Okay. So, and I can share that. I do have it here, just the direct conversation. People can hear what he had to say. I thought it was quite interesting. Did you want to share anything else regarding the Andronicus, or should I go right into?
Now you got the space. Now go for it.
Okay, so this is what Hans left said. He was some type of Andromedan. I would say military, or you know, someone that was on a ship, and he said something about deep 6-9. Quadrant 811 or 8-11-2-16 virtual trust, and then something about planet Gib. They might be talking trying to take over Geb, but they called it Gib, I guess. And then he said the following: Island Man, Safe Warrior, Coalition Group, Reptile Servant, we now break your frequency. So I think he was calling, I heard him calling them out. And they said they're coming from Quadrant 8. They were telling me that they were coming from Quadrant 8, and they are a group here to help. They're Andromedan. And then they said, happy to see you guys are still alive. You finally broke through. They said the Dracos were blocking us. So there must have been a Draco shield or something that was up. Then he said the reptilian base of the United Kingdom of, it says Hellward, but I don't know if that was the right term. Dominix, Platarix, Rex Guard is over Schiphol Airport. I think they were talking about this group that was over Schiphol Airport, which is the Netherlands, and I'm probably saying it incorrectly. And so it was a reptilian group that had a presence over the airport. And the Andromedans said, we are signed into your planet now. There are 80 accounts of statutory rape against others who were sent as ambassadors of the planet. The regulatory events will provide an upper court martial of 30-foot soldiers, air soldiers, and astral soldiers of the reptilian fleet. Violation code 326411C19X plus minus or correlate division symbol 922, the insignia flora alphanumera We have been waiting for this for a very long time. This moment is very important to us. We have finally identified the many hidden crimes in our galaxy and the source thereof. We want to thank you, young eons. Oh, one of them was an eon that I was doing the personal session for your support. And he was calling himself Hans Left. And then he reformed us. I have a Palladian counterfeit here on the planet called Hans Right. And that was pretty much the information. Here again is the quadrant that Andronicus used to bring up, deep 6-9. So I don't know, maybe they were under the water too. Planet Gib reminded me of Geb. Island Man, so they're talking about someone in particular, calling one of them Island Man, the other one Safe Warrior Coalition Group, of this reptile, and then there was a reptilian servant, and then they were speaking to them saying, we now break your frequency. So that's when they informed me that they were coming from Quadrant 8. And that they're here to help, and that they're Andromedan. And then he mentions to us, we're happy to see that you're alive. They said that the Dracos were blocking us. And then something about the reptilian base of this United Kingdom of Hellward, or something like that they were calling it, Dominic's, Platarix, Rexguard. And then they said the airport, Schiphol, and that it was a reptilian group. So then they have the violation code, the insignia flora, alpha numera. But the thing that I had to look up, I don't know why, I just blanked on statutory rape. So what I looked up, and it's like an underage violation. And it is against others who were sent as ambassadors of the planet. So incarnated children who were actually ambassadors from other regions, that they did this to you and had no awareness. They just thought they were humans. But because they did that, it stood out even more, and that's how they were able to catch them. But there were 80 accounts of this, I guess, and probably... I imagine there's more than that, but so that just happened the other day.
These are reptilians posing as humans, are they? With human form.
Yeah, I mean, from what they did is they actually grabbed a hold of all of those reptilians that were over the airport. Ironically, I had I knew someone that was having trouble. And they were traveling through the airport, and it was kind of like a lot of anomalies, a lot of weird things going on there. So, I mean, that sort of happened right around the same time. But I don't doubt that when these things happen, that it sort of opens up and reveals. So somewhere or another, the Andromedans were able to step through and do this. Now, I don't know how far back in time-space they came to come and help us, but it's been a long time ago where the Andromedans were taken over by the Vinkala, and so this is the same group that they've been searching for, that they've been warning us about and letting us know over the past 3 years about their presence, and obviously it sounds like they were very instrumental in some of this pedophilia stuff that's been going on.
Yeah, it seems a coincidence. When did you receive this message, Jess?
This came in on it was Saturday afternoon. So.
Right, because it's only recently that Epstein. Who is the American?
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Who's the American billionaire who's finally got taken in?
Yeah. Yeah, the guy from the whole, it's the Pizzagate or...
Oh, what's his name?
Yeah, Epstein.
Epstein, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because...
I don't even want to say his name. It's just disgusting.
The 7th. So I remember the 7th. Sunday.
So probably would have been the 6th.
So, and then straight away, they, you know, there's a lot, there's been a lot of smoke around this case, and he's finally been arrested for the he had a private island where there was I'm thinking lots of kind of mind controlled children.
Yeah, and some the problem is that some of these children are star seeds, so it works against them.
They probably end up in these places because they're targeted because of that. Yeah.
Well, they're gifted, usually identified as gifted children.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm thinking when he said when Han said that, it kind of like because they do bring these children into these programs, you know. Because it kind of defiles them, and it's kind of from their point of view, it's a bit of a joke, you know. And but at the same time, it weakens their memory, and it loosens their potential to do their job properly.
And now I'm not positive that this was their one and only location. It's very possible that they had been there for some agenda and then move into various locations. So, you know, they're kind of like a moving target. Mm. And it just, you know, the whole thing, I would call it like a sting operation. It was just the whole thing set up. And so you can see why they've been holding me back and holding me back from coming forward and sharing the transmissions, because all this stuff's going on in the background.
Mm.
And so that... For as far as I'm concerned, I'm so thrilled that they caught them. I mean, it's been very long overdue, but you could see how the Dracos were blocking and protecting the reptilians.
Yeah.
And then, you know, some people are saying, oh, no, the reptilians have reformed and they're doing this and that. Well, and I said this early on in the transmissions, how I got abducted multiple times by the reptilians, and many people in my labs have seen reptilians. And so it's, you know, it's all around us. And but they're influencing humans. They can come and even show up and shapeshift like humans, so, and look like famous people, and you know, we don't know what's going on. Mm. It's a lot of trickery, a lot of stuff. So this is not pointing out the Netherlands in particular. I mean, it could be any place in the U.S. could be any place in Europe,
UK,
place you in Asia or Africa or anywhere. It's whoever they're looking for, whatever their agenda was. The problem is this stuff was so widespread, you know. So, you know, they caught them. So they'll go after the ones that are doing it. They're not gonna, and those that are just, you know, depleted souls, and they're so open, they're being used. I don't know what happens to them. I mean, they, you know, it's like they're almost zombies without these entities in them.
Mm.
So it's really hard, you know. That's why you always care for your consciousness and don't violate your own consciousness, and keep yourself protected. And if you don't feel comfortable doing something, don't do it. It doesn't matter. You know, I know there's a lot of things in this world that tell you to compromise yourself. And it's you know, set up that way because, you know, if people are not in their body properly and they're not strong, you know, then they can easily be manipulated and, you know, become a part of the slave system. So you want to keep yourself strong.
Yeah.
So with that said, I think that's the end of the transmissions. And if there's any last thoughts, Ian, that you wanted to share?
But things seem to be moving in the right direction, don't they? With a lot of work behind the scenes.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm happy. I'm a little tired, but I'm happy. Happy that things are going in the direction that they're going. But there's still more ahead.
Yeah.
And, you know, thank you to many people that send me information here and there. Oh, there's one last thing that I wanted to share, and I hope to have this on the video as a link. Someone sent me a link regarding this earthquake that was happening, and they were seeing actually the shape of the Shiva Lingam, you know, actually, you know, the shape of it in the earth, where the epicenter was of the earthquakes in California. And it's making it look like Shiva's involved in this, and everyone loves calling Shiva the destroyer. And Shiva's not the destroyer. The creator destroyer is someone that is bringing something in. And I explained it to someone. They said, go ahead and share it in that way. It might help people to understand. Well, when you're making a cake, you put eggs, you put flour, you put, you know, all these different things. And in a sense, the actual elements of all these different foods coming together creates a whole other substance, similar to like chemistry. When you're creating something, things get destroyed in the process in order to create something new. It does not mean he's just out destroying things. So they're using this and his symbology and his technology as a license to make it look like he's out to destroy the earth, and of course have him coined as the devil or whatever. And I thought it was quite interesting because there is, you know, he's a very, very ancient being, has been on the planet, and did leave some tech here and created some things here. So the lingam itself has some kind of energy, and I thought it was interesting. And the person that was that did the video, you know, recognized the shape and recognized, you know, it as a technology. And so we can see, you know, of course, CERN does the same thing. You know, has Shiva doing the sacred dance in front of their facility, which really is completely misplaced, doesn't belong there at all. There is no practicing Shaivites there. So, you know, it's like putting a religious symbolism in front of something and then, you know, saying that they have permission to look for something or to just, you know, do in their quantum experimentation and so forth. So, yeah, I think it's the whole thing is very, very interesting. Maybe people could take a look at it, give your feedback. But the ancient tech has power, has knowledge, understands how to work in our field, in our quantum level, and so forth. And so, you know, we're still learning from some of the stuff, you know, the Vimanas and stuff that they've found, you know, obviously are operational. And we're learning space travel, interdimensional travel from some of these different things. So it wouldn't be surprising if technology, knowledge of that technology got into the wrong hands, that they're manipulating, whether it's weather or, you know, here, earthquakes, so forth, interesting enough, close enough to the San Andreas Fault. So here again, like I said earlier, I mentioned about the Alcyon group that was opening up this portal and just, you know, starting this stuff. But you can actually see this all, this shape also revealing there too. So I thought it was interesting. So that, I guess that's it. Mm-hmm. Not to keep talking and talking and talking, but thank you, Ian, so much for joining me today, and I appreciate your feedback and your ideas.
Welcome, Jess. Nice to be here as always.
Yeah, and it's nice to be doing this again. And thank you to everyone listening. I appreciate your patience and waiting for the information. Hopefully this gives you some things to think about. Goodbye, everyone, and have a good day. For the 15th century.